Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null, broadcasting out of the state. I'm in the midst of post-hurricane cleanup. It's out of the news cycle, but I can tell you, driving up and down all the streets of southwestern Florida, there's not a street that has not been adversely affected. And you see debris stacked 6-7 feet high, street after street. So people are rebuilding. A little later on, not today, but on an upcoming program, I'll talk about the areas that I believe are the safest, most sustainable places in America to live. Now, I'm taking into consideration whether you're younger, single, married, with family, older, have a job you can do in another area or not. I've tried to accommodate as many different questions people would ask before they would make a move. But are we going to have to move? You bet. Tens of millions, probably as many as 100 million people, should be planning on moving. Not all be able to afford it. So shouldn't we make this the new Marshall Plan for America? Because some areas have been hit with such devastation, such as Puerto Rico. Remember, they're U.S. citizens, that's U.S. protectorate, and they're U.S. Virgin Islands, plus Florida. Southern Florida is no longer sustainable, period. Anyone who tells you otherwise is simply disingenuous, intentionally negligent of the facts, or has some other agenda, because it's only going to get worse. California, the entire state of California, is no longer sustainable. I have a lot of listeners. After being out there for decades on KPFK, 6 hours every week, the people when I left there, and by the way, I left there for two reasons, and I won't mention one of the reasons yet. I will on an upcoming program, and it'll surprise some of the people, because I would not raise money for how that money was being spent. That's all I'll say. And I just, on ethical issues, I once I found out the problem, I would no longer do it. In any case, you don't have a place in the state that's safe in the future. In fact, you could save for nearly 9,000, or more or less, homes and buildings that were destroyed or are being destroyed now. And with the worst fires in Southern California history around Los Angeles, and the worst fire in California's entire history, that will be the new normal. In fact, it'll probably be to where in the next 5 years you'll have so many fires, so often in the state, so many farms going bankrupt, so much of the water, scarce as it is, being used for agriculture, that agriculture itself will start relocating to places that are more sustainable. And that'll actually be a good thing. So I'm going to do a whole program on that because I've been asked, and I will. And I'm going to show you before and after photographs of what I've been able to do in cleanup, because that might also help other people who are facing similar situations. What do I do? Do I cut a tree down that's out of the ground? Do I put it back up? How do I do it? All that coming up. Today, lots on health and nutrition, but then we're going to have Chris Hedges on to talk about at least 15 different issues that are important to us today. Also, from time to time, I like to reconstruct real history, since so much of real history has been altered by those in power or for political, ideological, or religious reasons. So I'm going to show you why people are angry at us. Why are they wanting to hurt us? Is it because of our religious beliefs, our standard of living? Is it because they consider us decadent? No, none of the above. A real reason why we're not touching this topic and won't. Let's begin. Alzheimer's disease is going to be the top killer, probably starting in about 10 years. When my generation, baby boomers, get into their advanced years, we're just going to be one giant brain damage group. Unfortunately, we're doing absolutely nothing to prevent that from coming. We're just in denial of it. We're not changing our diets. The people changing their diets, ironically enough, are young people. And I'm very happy to see that. In fact, more young people today are changing to a healthier diet, including vegan diets or vegetarian diets, than at any time in my lifetime, and I helped lead the organic back-to-the-land movement in the 1960s and 70s with the first teaching organic farm in the East Coast of the United States. The only other one was Rodell in Emmaus, Pennsylvania. Nice man, by the way, and a real pioneer. But I went down there several times, and he was mainly growing amaranth and other things. He wasn't having teaching seminars. Well, I actually taught probably 10 to 15,000 people upstate in Stone Ridge, in a relatively small area. The place was 50 acres, but the place that I focused attention on was only 1 acre. A lot of people learned from that. But most of the people then were not young. They were in their middle 40s. And I was in my young 20s. And so I was hopeful more young people would become involved in it. They didn't. Today, it's young people. Young people that attend the webinars. You wouldn't believe how many people listen in on a recent webinar. But they want to know things. What to do when disasters strike. That's young people. Where to live in America that's safe and sustainable. That's young people. What to do to prevent brain aging. It's not older people. It's younger people. So why would you ask someone in their 20s or 30s or 40s wanting to know about brain aging? Because the new aging, meaning when your body's actually getting older, and we now define that as, you know, you're getting old at 27. That's how much of an assault we've led against our bodies. And right at the top of that list is Alzheimer's and dementia. From the University of British Columbia, they came up with a new study published in Molecular Psychiatry, and it's really different. So here's what it says. Quote, Alzheimer's disease, the leading cause of dementia, has been assumed to originate in the brain. But research from the University of British Columbia and Chinese scientists indicate it could be triggered by breakdowns elsewhere in the body. And so they're looking at the toxic brain protein, the amyloids, and they're saying, well, gee whiz, we have a whole lot of other parts of the body that are diseasing, and those diseases are found elsewhere, meaning the plaque is found elsewhere, and they're finding that the higher the body produces anywhere, the plaque, the amyloid beta plaque, and in people with Alzheimer's disease, that protein ultimately forms clumps, or what we call plaques, that smother brain cells. What about the other plaque in our body? What about the plaque in our arteries? That's also important. So now they're looking at it as a whole body disease. Good for them, because that's how we've been looking at it, everyone in the holistic field, not as a brain disease by itself, but as a whole body disease. It's like you say, well, heart disease is the heart. No, the belly fat you have, if it's excessive, that's contributing to heart disease and your depression. No, depression is an emotional condition. No, being overweight and being diabetic increase depression. So we have to start looking, instead of a single set of symptoms in specific parts of the body, just simply saying, look, your blood courses through your body about every 6.5 minutes, hitting all your different cells. So anytime you have an inflammatory agent, you've eaten french fries, you've had a cola, you've had alcohol, even in moderate amounts socially, that's going through your blood and that's causing inflammation. Now, where you're most susceptible, let's say you have some purine, you have a lot of animal protein in a meal, that purine will probably create more of a reaction in your big toe. That's where gout generally manifests, but it can also manifest in your thumb, your fingers, between the joints. So you can't just say, gee whiz, I've got to treat my big toe, it's inflamed. You've got to change your whole body chemistry, because the blood doesn't have any magical construct that says purines only to the feet. They're going to the brain too. So inflammation anywhere in the body is inflammation everywhere in the body. So let's just write that down as a little mantra to help younger people and people who may not be aware. Inflammation anywhere in the body is inflammation everywhere in the body. Every single cell is going to be manifested because inflammatory cytokines go right through the blank barrier, through the placental barrier. The fact that you only manifest symptoms in some specific areas doesn't mean it's only causing problems there. It's just that's where you're most susceptible. So let's just start working with a more holistic model. Now, I'm willing to work with any licensed physician or nurse, holistic practitioner, on a holistic protocol. I've formulated protocols. We're seeing major improvement in people with Alzheimer's and dementia. And so I'm happy to share that with anyone. You just contact my office and we'll get you that. University of Arizona Cancer Center, they're saying that soy may be the new weapon against breast cancer. That's really good news. There's a whole lot of research on soy. Some of you may remember, I'm guessing now it's 15 years ago, there were two people running around the United States getting a lot of media attacking soy. And I read what they had to say, and it was half-truths. So I invited them on the show for debate. And they came on, and the first thing I asked him was, after I introduced him, I said, before we start, do you have any income coming through stipends, expenses, research, lecture fees, honorariums, from the dairy industry, the meat industry, the egg industry? And that was it. They hung up. I'm sure only Robert Gallo and Luc Montagnier, when I invited them to debate the issue of AIDS, they hung up. But that was unusual. And then a man said, well, he's got the research. He'll come on. So we did an hour debate, and he presented his studies about soy being bad. I think he had about five, and they were legitimate. If you had an exclusive soy diet, and you had, if you had enlarged thyroid or dysfunctional thyroid, then you shouldn't have that. I absolutely agree. I then presented, I didn't list everyone, needless to say, 5,300 studies showing the benefits of soy. And once again, I looked in the man's background, and he was supported by a major foundation that supports a high-protein, animal-based diet. Eggs, dairy, meat, chicken, fish. So you got to dig a little deeper when people are telling you soy is dangerous, it's a killer. It is not. I'm looking at non-genetically engineered soy. I'm looking at the Chinese people, the Japanese people that use a humongous amount of soy, more than anyone else in the world, and they're living longer lives. They're healthier. Colin Campbell found in a classic study that it was called the China Project, that people who eat principally a plant-based diet have very little cancer compared to those who eat a meat-based diet. So here's what they're saying now in this study from the University of Arizona Cancer Center. They're saying that the team's most recent study suggests that genistein, genistein, S-T-E-I-N, can protect the BRCA1. That's a gene that it's said, though I challenge this, is pivotal in thwarting tumor development in breast tissue. And the team is led by one of their top people. And a normally functioning breast cell, by the way, has estrogen receptors into which the body's natural estrogen fit like a key into a lock. That then regulates cell growth. So doctors can exploit these receptors by using, they're going to use drugs, which I disagree with. And that's how they deliver their chemotherapy to cancerous cells, with drugs like tamoxifen, which I don't believe anyone should ever be using, ever. I'll be happy to debate any doctor, any oncologist at any time on this show. You're pro-tamoxifen, bring your evidence. I'm anti-tamoxifen, I've got a lot of evidence. Let the audience listen and see which side of that debate, if either, they would agree with. But I believe that when you look at how much more cancer tamoxifen can cause women of color, and yet the doctors, the nurses, the oncologists are not differentiating on a person's ethnicity or race when it comes to the drugs they're giving, and they should be, because the scientific literature is there to support why there's a danger there. So many breast tumors, this receptor is missing, rendering tamoxifen ineffective. So BRCA1 is a tumor suppressor gene. So when working normally, it helps keep DNA stable and protecting against genetic diseases like cancer, when it is genetically, but it's more often than not 95% of all cancers, lifestyle. So when the BRCA1 is performing abnormally, the body's defenses against cancer are impaired. Now, although a small percentage of breast cancers are caused by mutations in the BRCA1, many other breast cancer patients have normal copies, but the genes have been methylated, meaning wrapped in strands of carbon-based molecules that render them unreadable. And a BRCA1 gene silenced in this manner is unable to do its job as a tumor suppressor. So one receptor, what is called the aromatic hydrocarbon receptor, or AHR, activated by environmental carcinogens like dioxin, tobacco smoke, products of ultraviolet light, and some fatty acid metabolites, is a particular interest in the research. And what they found is that the aromatic hydrocarbon receptor silences the BRCA1, triggering a cascade of undesirable effects. So when that BRCA1 is unable to carry out its duties as a tumor suppressor, cancerous cells can proliferate. And one weapon that can be used to target AHR is found in soy. Now, soy is a very high-quality protein. It's a legume that is a major source of compounds called the flavones, F-L-A-V-O-N-E-S. And so when you look at the Asian women, they have a substantially reduced risk of breast cancer, and that's because one of those isoflavones, genistein, is the predominant isoflavone found in soy, and it can actually block the DNA methylation, hence the silencing of the BRCA1 gene. So one more reason why you should be using organic, non-GMO soy as one part, not an excessive part, as one part of an overall well-balanced program, and or taking genistein by itself. And finally, ashwagandha. It's a root. And good news for those of you who are having hormone problems, you're not overeating, yet you're gaining weight. You suddenly don't have the energy, physical energy, the mental energy, even the libido energy that you once had. Could be because you're not having the right hormone stimulation and production for your thyroid gland. So research was done at the Subhanawana Hospital in India, and they used ashwagandha, ash, A-S-H, wag, W-A-G, onda, A-N-D-H-A. And it's been used as an herbal remedy for hundreds of years to help the body deal with stress. So extracts of ashwagandha root helps normalize levels of serum thyroid hormones. And that's important. And that's what they found. So people who have underactive thyroid have metabolic problems. Read the article in the Journal of Alternative and Complementary Medicine. Quote, the results indicate a possible role for ashwagandha in regulating HPT axis. The anti-stress cortisol-lowering effect of ashwagandha may provide a suitable explanation for the current outcome. Well, by the way, for those who understand Ayurveda, Ayurveda, by the way, is one of the greatest healing systems in the world. A-Y-U-R-V-E-D-A. Ayurveda. And they've been using ashwagandha for other reasons. There's a lot more it does. It helps suppress stress. It helps enhance cognitive function. It helps sleep. Helps metabolic wellness. Helps adrenal function if you're exhausted. Sports performance. So it's not by itself as a great study. Oh, and by the way, spicy foods may curb unhealthy cravings for salt. That's according to a medical university in China published in the peer-reviewed journal Hypertension. And what they did in this study in China, those people who had the highest level of spicy foods ate the least amount of salt, and that lowered their blood pressure. And what they found was it was the capsaicin. That's the red pepper. And it made a big difference. I'm sure they did this study also in Korea, South Korea, and in other countries like Japan and in India that also use pepper, that have found also lower blood pressure from using the spices. That's the latest on health and healing. I'm Gary Null. Back in a moment. Please stay with us. I'd like to welcome all of you who are just tuning in. Any reasonable and responsible person would want to know, why are people willing to kill themselves, but before that, kill a lot of people who have nothing to do with anything that has happened to these people in their own country? Why do they hate us? And of course, we've been told by pundits that they hate us for the following reasons, and it's generally because of our success and our standard of living and our democracy, our principles of freedom. And I don't buy that at all. I believe it's far more than that. And so I'd like to share my own particularly lesson in history of what could be some of the other reasons why people would be willing to want to attack Americans. First, when you watch television now, what you're seeing is nonstop military interventionists. The people coming forward as experts are never told, we're never told, the public's never told, what is their background? Who's paying them? Now, here are the neocon institutions and some of the libertarian groups leaning towards neocons. The Foundation for Defense Democracies, the Henry Jackson Society, the Hoover Institute, that's at Stanford University, the Hudson Institute, that has nothing to do with Michael Hudson, by the way, the Jewish Institute for National Security Affairs, the National Security Advisory Council, the National Institute for Public Policy, the Project for a New American Century. That, to me, is one of the worst. I mean, the worst of the worst. The Heritage Foundation, the Alliance for Securing Democracy, the Alliance for a Strong America. By the way, that's Dick and Liz Cheney. The American Enterprise Institute, the Center for American Freedom, the Center for Security Policy, the Committee for Present Danger, the Emergency Committee for Israel, Foreign Policy Initiative, the Foundations for Secure and Prosperous Americans. By the way, that's Rick, Dick Reed and McCain and Lindsey Graham, the John Hay Initiative, and that's Chris Christie and Rubio and Walker and Perry and Cruz, Graham. Keep America Safe, Republican Jewish Coalition. By the way, it's funded by Sheldon Adelson. The Republican Main Street Partnership, Washington Free Beacon, the Washington Institute for Near East Policy, the Washington Post. There's your Jennifer Rubin, your Michael Gerson, your Fred Hyatt, your Jackson Deal, and Mark Thiessen, and the Weekly Standard. And their publications promoting the neocon, neoliberal, pro-war agendas, Policy Review, The Public Interest, The Weekly Standard, and The Washington Free Beacon. And the PAC groups are the Elliot Abrams, Richard Armitage, the William Bennetts, the Jeffrey Bergner, John Bolton, Paula Dobrinsky, Francis Fukuyama, Frank Gaffney, and Robert Kagan. He's the senior fellow at the Brookings Institute. And Zalme Kalasad, William Crystal, Richard Pearl, Donald Rumsfeld, William Schneider, Vin Weber, Paula Dunes Wolfowitz, Paul Wolfowitz, and Jay Woolsey, and some of the prominent ones, because these are the ones you're going to see on television, radio, and hear them on NPR, Fred Barnes, Paul Bremer, Arthur Brooks, Douglas Feith, David Frum, Newt Gingrich, Gene Kilpatrick, Henry Kissinger, Charles Krauthammer, and Irving Kristol, and Michael Levine, and Rupert Murdoch, and Douglas Murray, and Richard Newhouse, and Michael Novick, and Daniel Pipes, Carl Rove, Jennifer Rubin, she's a columnist for the Washington Post, and Robert Zolik. Now, I give you all that because you wouldn't know that all these people are completely interrelated, wired at the hip when it comes to being pro-intervention, and every single action they're going to say, now you see, we need to have an aggressive foreign policy. We need more money going into Homeland Defense. We need more security cameras, more DNA checks. So they're the ones guiding what will ultimately be a police state. They are the deep state. They are connected to the ideology that promotes fascism and totalitarianism. That's my personal opinion. But I want you to know, next time you see one of them on Sean Hannity, like Bolton, or Newt Gingrich, know they have a background. Know someone's paying them. Know that they're there as a spokesperson. But you're never told anything other than my guest is, and maybe from some foundation or think tank, what is the background of that think tank? Now imagine where the world would be today if we didn't get lied to by Obama on Libya. He said Gaddafi was suppressing his citizens and NATO regime was to protect Libyan citizens. Well, it was all lies. And he said Assad was using poisonous gas on his citizens, and he was not. And he said Ukraine was not a coup. Yeah, it was. He said the United States was not behind it. The United States orchestrated it. And it was due to Russian infiltration in Ukraine. Not true. And he said Obamacare was a health insurance premium would go down and everybody would cover and you could carry on a doctor. It was all lies. The whole Obamacare was written by the insurance industry. And James Clapper lies before Congress about national security collecting data on citizens. Have you heard anyone, left or right, say that James Clapper should be held in contempt of Congress because he out and out lied? No. And Fast and Furious, the Department of Justice, alcohol and tobacco, gun running operations and allowing guns to be sold to the Mexican drug cartels in hopes of recovering some of the same ones in crime scenes. And who would have accepted that? The Trans-Pacific Partnership, the Trans-TTIP, would be good for American business and employment and U.S. economy. It would be devastating, except to those who were in control of it. So everything we've been told, from TARP and bailing out the banks to Obama's foreclosure relief program, it did not help homeowners. So we've been lied to nonstop. So is it any wonder then, when we look back at some past atrocities from earlier administrations, that maybe, just maybe, we should think, wow, that's a reason they might not like us. Instead of sending ambassadors of peace and religious leaders to countries to try to, apologize for what has been done to the citizens of a country, from regime change to cluster bombs and drones to total destruction of their infrastructure. Maybe we should be there to be empathetic and to heal those wounds. But we don't do that. We just double down and do more of the same. In fact, a study concluded that the United States is directly responsible for killing over 20 million people in 37 countries since World War II. Indirectly, this figure is much higher, close to 30 million. Little examples, historical facts. Israel and Palestine. The U.S. is the primary weapons donor to Israel. 200,000 Palestinians throughout its history in this conflict with Israel dead. In the Iraq War, the most conservative estimate, 654,000 killed, that's according to Johns Hopkins. However, 1.2 million is a different figure. Under Bill Clinton, 1990 and ongoing, Somalia Civil War. Since 1993, up to 1 million deaths, including 350,000 by starvation. Somalian massacre occurred in 1993 under Clinton's watch. In Clinton's first term, Iraqi sanctions, 567,000 children conservatively killed. That means 4,000 children under 5 years of age were killed under Clinton, died because of sanctions, per month. And yet Madeleine Albright gets up and on 60 Minutes with Leslie Saul and says, was it worth it? Yeah, it was worth it. Sorry, you don't have the right, nor have you been elected or approved to say what child under four or over four is an acceptable death for our foreign policy and Hillary and Bill Clinton's foreign policy. A literacy rate before the sanctions, are you ready for this? In Iraq was 93% to 95%. That was higher in the United States. After the sanctions, 20%. 1992 to 95, the Bosnia War, 100,000 killed, 69% were civilians. 1994 in Rwanda, I have absolutely irrefutable proof that the head of the UN mission in Rwanda made multiple efforts to stop the massacre, could have stopped the massacre, knew where the weapons were, they were going to use machetes and other weapons, wanted to raid it, and he was told to stand down. When there was 2,200 plus the Tutsi in a church, and it had been guarded, I think it was guarded by either the Italians or Belgians, and those troops were leaving, the whole church was surrounded by the Hutu, and they were slapping machetes on their pants. And once the last ones left, the UN was there, could have gone in and protected those 2,000. They were told, stand down. And every one of those men, women, and children were killed. They would bring, it was so defiant that they would bring women outside the consulate, outside of the UN building, in the street, right in front of them. Here are all these armed UN soldiers, and they were putting the women in and making a circle where the women are in the side, and they would go up and they would whack the women with machetes. They weren't going for a kill shot initially. They were going to strike them so they would be damaged and bleed to death. And they would do that all day long. Again, he wanted to intervene and stop it. He was told, stand down. Ask Hillary Clinton, those of you who thought she would be this great goddess and lead us into a new era of wonderment, what her and her husband were doing, because we have the evidence that they knew this and they were the ones telling the UN, stand down. Why doesn't anyone in the liberal community ever hold them responsible for anything that they've done? What the hell's wrong with you? This is genocide, but that doesn't matter. Genocide seems to be an acceptable outcome as long as you're getting your positions of power and what you believe is important. And oh, by the way, let's not us forget 2009 Honduras. Now, we have no complete figures, but sporadic killings all over the continue, 1,000 deaths by 2014, including a slaughter of 160 lesbian and gay and transgender people. In 2000, that's under Hillary Clinton. She's the one behind the Honduras coup. Why not hold her accountable? If you're for women, why aren't you for the women of Honduras? Do they not count? Libya, according to Amnesty International, actual number of deaths is unknown, but they estimate 30,000 civilians, plus they're not even counting the 50,000 workers from Nigeria and other countries that were also slaughtered there. They had over 50,000 wounded, and so we have left the country a complete shambles. So why isn't she bringing Bach back on television and you show the one side of her, we came, we saw, he died, ha ha ha, and then show a picture of what it was like him being sodomized with a bayonet until he died. And ask, what did Gaddafi do that threatened the United States or its people or exported terrorism? He didn't. And I've gone through enough of what he did for his people to make it an example that we should not have been invading Libya. Syria, the same, 300,000 to 470,000 people. And Ukraine, mostly in Donbass region, 9,100, which is a very conservative figure. And those, understand you've got now a Ukrainian fascist government that we represent. And also in the Yemen war, yeah, did you forget that? Why isn't that on the front page? How many people have color? How many people are starving to death? It's one of the greatest humanitarian crises in the world. Could it be because we're supporting Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, Kuwait, and other countries that are engaged in destroying this tiny little speck of a country, the poorest country in the Middle East? At least 10,000 deaths, 40,000 wounded, that's according to the United Nations figures, and not a word. So those are just a few And tomorrow, I'll give you more cases. I'll give you 69 countries we have intervened in, overthrown their democratically elected governments, and what it's meant to the people in those to be colonized by a new privatization policy in those countries. I will also give you a list of the relationships where the United States and our full power of government, State Department, Defense Department, has been in support of dictatorships and hegemony groups around the world, like Egypt, for example. It's just one example, and Saudi Arabia is another example. And then ask, what is it like to be in those countries, and what difference could that have made in the people's lives and quality of life, or even freedom in those countries? So why shouldn't we be also discussing this as a possible motive for the constant recruitment of people who end up then killing innocent Americans or people in other countries? We better pull the curtain back completely so we can see in proper context, in a historical context, what the United States could have done or did do to create such animus against us. Back in a moment with my guest. Please stay with us.
Send a telegram, oh, send a telegram to my baby. This is what I want you to say. Want you to tell her that I'm all alone.
I'd like to welcome all of you. We're going over to Princeton, New Jersey now. We're standing by as Chris Hedges. He is one of our nation's most insightful cultural critics and social and political activist and investigative journalist. And for more than 20 years, he was the foreign correspondent in war zones and conflicts in Central America, the Middle East, Africa, and the Balkans, reporting for the New York Times, the Christian Science Monitor. And he is also a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist. And he also has an Unspeakable out now, talks with David Talbot about the most forbidden topics in America, which is a candid conversation on some of the most important issues and themes of our times that mainstream media refuses to discuss. He also does a weekly talk show I highly recommend called On Contact, interviews prominent dissidents ignored by the media, and airs every Sunday on Russian TV at RT.com. Nice to have you with us, Chris.
Thank you, Gary.
Chris, first, would you give us your input before I go to the issues I'd like for you to deal with on why we refuse in the media, including much of the alternative media, to examine our own historical interference in countries that may have precipitated someone desiring to do harm to people around the world as terrorists?
Well, because the maintenance of empire requires that we see empire as, if not only benevolent, but even virtuous, and this has been true for every empire. The British Empire kind of invented that whole mythology, because you're asking essentially the working class to pay with blood. You're asking the taxpayer to pay with money. Empire is always about the seizure or control of natural resources abroad, cheap labor pools on behalf of business and corporate interests. I mean, that's what that's how empire was created. In the case of the British, the whole pillage of began with essentially attacks on Spanish shipping out of Latin America and control of South Africa and India and everything else. So the empire has always required this, and the media is almost always compliant, so it presents an image of empire that is at complete variance with the reality of empire. And one of the things that's difficult for people such as myself, who spent 20 years on the outer reaches of empire as a reporter, is conveying that reality of its brutality and its savagery. And one of the things that's dangerous about empire is that the harsh tools of repression, control, wholesale surveillance, militarized police, drones, stripping away of civil liberties. As these militaries expand beyond their capacity to sustain themselves, they hollow the empire out from the inside, which is how we get our decayed cities and half the country now living in poverty or near poverty. And then they bring back these tools of control to the homeland, which is precisely what we're seeing. So the whole truth about empire itself has a vested interest in making sure that truth is suppressed and replaced with myth.
Thank you. Chris, yesterday, with that horrific killing spree, I went immediately to the news media, and I looked to see not what was being said specifically, but who they were having on as the producer's choice to discuss it. And in virtually every single case, and it didn't matter which media I was dealing with, they were having on people that never defined their ideological background. They were simply to be given a platform and let them talk about what the solution was. And always the solution was, we've got to do more, become more aggressive, put more money in the military-industrial complex, do more spying, but they didn't say spying, they said more intelligence, more DNA gathering, etc. So I just, before you came on, I gave a list of over 40 different institutions, like the Heritage Foundations, and the different commentators that you're going to hear or watch on television, radio, or in the print. And all these people are the ones who always had the platform. You're not invited on. Cornel West is not invited on. Glenn Ford, Naylor Bailey is not invited on. Dixon is not invited on. The people who have a different approach to conflict or why we may be in this situation are never invited on. Have you found this to be the case yourself?
Well, I mean, let's take the Middle East, although, you know, I've been out of the Middle East for a while, but a decade ago I hadn't. I spent 7 years in the Middle East. I was the Middle East bureau chief for the New York Times. I speak Arabic. And I was never invited on because I wouldn't buttress the official narrative. And your expertise in the region is irrelevant if you're not going to sing the tune they play. It's all, you know, quite frightening in terms of the paucity of ideas that are reflected now within the corporate media. There's no real, what they argue over is, you know, what Freud would call the narcissism of minor difference. So do we go into Syria with troops or do we just bomb Syria, as if those are the two choices? And of course, you have powerful economic interests that have a vested interest in maintaining these conflicts, Raytheon, Halliburton, General Electric, which of course owns a television station, a cable channel. All of these forces, I think at this point, have to realize that the wars have been an unmitigated disaster. We're losing the war in Afghanistan. It's not good for the Afghan people. It's not good for us, but it's very good for business. And the intertwining, I think, of the corporate media entities, which are very different from the old media empires, like the Hearst media empire. That was a media empire, and he was guilty for stoking and in many ways creating the Spanish-American War as a kind of narrative to boost circulation and readership. But now it's even more pernicious because you have a cable news outlet, let's say MSNBC, they're just one of innumerable revenue streams, and they compete against other revenue streams. And that's how they're judged. And you've seen it with the complete destruction of CNN as a credible news source under Zucker. And there was quite a chilling and, I thought, very good interview in the New York Times with Zucker, and he was quite frank. I mean, first of all, he's the person who created the fictional persona of Donald Trump because he was overseeing The Apprentice at NBC, and then he comes into CNN, and he models it quite consciously on ESPN. I mean, even he was saying to the point where he's putting his anchors outside, and we would put, you know, anchors for a football game outside a stadium, that he brings on these, you know, incredibly ludicrous pro-Trump supporters whose only you know, who have no reason to have a platform on national news, but are there because they will express the racist, xenophobic, mythology that characterizes the Trump White House, and then they can fight with a Democratic figure like Van Jones. And it's all carnival. It's all burlesque. And it's not news. And I think that the media is deeply complicit in what's happened in terms of the destruction of real journalism, which should be a bulwark to protecting our democracy, and in fact has become an enabler of this endless reality show that characterizes now the American government.
I'm going to ask you to address several issues that are not being discussed in the mainstream media, and there are a wide variety. And if you could give us just your short summation on this, an overview, I want to try to get as many as I can in. There is an article on Countercurrents by Thomas C. Mountain. It's called Shia Insurrection in Saudi Arabia, and it talks about a battle for a community. And then it has a photograph, and it shows that this was a thriving Shia community, but Saudi Arabia is principally Sunni, and Saudi Arabia went in there and virtually destroyed the entire city. Everything was destroyed. The picture shows you every building's completely destroyed. That's one. But then Saudi Arabia is also responsible for what's going on in Yemen, and we don't hear anything to condemn it in the mainstream media. How it's going into its own country, in Saudi Arabia, destroying towns in its own country, but mainly Shia. Your thoughts?
Well, yes, of course, because they're huge buyers of weapons. And what was it? I think Obama signed a $30 billion weapon deal with the Saudis before he left office. And again, Saudi Arabia has been far more involved with acts of terror, including, of course, 9/11, than Iran. And it's all about the fact that they have oil revenues to buy money. I mean, you have the Trump administration now putting together a $100 billion arms deal with the Saudis. And many of these things, these precision-guided bombs and planes and everything else, will be used for this genocidal campaign in Yemen. But it comes down to business, which is, of course, why we have the demonization of Russia. It's and the expansion of NATO. And Ronald Reagan who had promised Gorbachev after the fall of the Berlin Wall that NATO would not be expanded beyond Germany. Well, it's expanded because these arms manufacturers want new markets, which they've got. I was in Warsaw a year ago and landed at the airport, and the first thing I see is a gigantic billboard from Raytheon. And they have to convert their Soviet-era weaponry into NATO-compatible weaponry. It's a huge deal. And to do that, they have to stoke fears with Russia and push NATO right up to Russia's border. So it's the destruction of all rational diplomacy and sense of balance within the world, and it's the kind of giddy excess of markets, which at this point are determining how we relate to the world with disastrous consequences.
I was surprised to read an article by Ryan Grimm in The Intercept, and it's entitled "The Taliban Tried to Surrender and the U.S. Rebuffed Them. Now here we are." Quote, "Did you know that shortly after the United States invaded Afghanistan, the Taliban tried to surrender? For centuries in Afghanistan, when a rival force had come to power, the defeated one would put down their weapons and be integrated into the new power structure, obviously with much less power or none at all. That's how you do with neighbors you have to continue to live with."
And this is the great tragedy of Afghanistan. If we had gone in and pulled out. First of all, the whole idea that we should go to war with the Taliban never made any sense. Al-Qaeda had sanctuary under the Taliban, but there's no evidence that they knew anything about the attacks of 9/11. Al-Qaeda, because of corrupt Afghan army officials, which were paid off, hightailed it over the border largely into Pakistan out of Tora Bora, and were never, nobody of any significance was ever captured. And then we went to war with the Taliban. None of it makes any sense. unless you look at it as a business, then it makes some sense. But the whole debacle in Afghanistan, and I would, you know, include Iraq and the expansion of these wars now into Yemen and Somalia and Niger and everywhere else, is probably the greatest strategic blunder in American history. You know, it is equatable, and all empires do it in their kind of dying moments where they overreach. You had in the Peloponnesian War, Thucydides writes about the Greeks attacking Sicily. I think they lost like 200 ships and thousands of men, and it was over. Revolts rose up all throughout the Greek Empire. You look at 1956, where the British attempted to invade Suez after Nasser, the Egyptian leader Gamal Abdel Nasser, had nationalized it. They had to retreat in humiliation. Their empire disintegrated, what was left of it after that. And I think this is what's happening with where we are now, that we have overreached. And, you know, certainly we have no legitimacy left in terms of foreign policy. Brzezinski and others had made this point with the invasion of Iraq because it was unilateral and not condoned by even many of our closest allies like the French. And now we have the specter of Donald Trump, who is, you know, not the disease. He's the symptom of the disease. He's what you get in a decayed system of governance, you know, which happened in all sorts of other late empires, including the Roman Empire, when you got these figures like Nero, Caligula, Commodius. That's kind of who Trump is. So what we're watching is the kind of denouement of the American empire, and we are going down the way empires traditionally go down.
This is from the Daily Chapon. It says, AT&T's secret spy program unveiled Project Hemisphere, quote, Project Hemisphere, a secret program developed by AT&T, searches trillions of call records in order to analyze cell phone data, spying on the activity of private individuals in order to identify who they are speaking with and why, as well as GPS tracking on the location of each individual connected to the call. And it transmits this to the Department of Justice. So most people are not aware of a Project Hemisphere and that their cell phone, every single call they make, every single thing they send, is now in the hands of AT&T to do with it what it wants.
Yeah, I mean, and if it was just AT&T, we might be all right. But, you know, they've got, we're constantly photographed, electronically monitored on the Internet, you know, biosensors. They have the whole black industry where we don't have access to it, but they have all of our medical records, judicial record, I mean, everything about us that companies buy. And I think that Hannah Arendt, in The Origins of Totalitarianism, when she talked about wholesale surveillance, correctly pointed out that this kind of surveillance, and you can't, by the way, use the word liberty when your government watches you 24 hours a day. That's the relationship of a master and a slave. This kind of wholesale surveillance is not about discovering crime. But to have information on hand when the government decides to arrest a certain category of the population. And that's what totalitarian systems do. It's what the Stalinists did. It's, you know, what the old East German Stasi did. And that's what they're doing to us. So everything, emails, phone conversations, web searches, even our movements, of course, are tracked. We all carry trackers on behalf of the government. It's all recorded. It's all stored in perpetuity in government databases so that the moment they need, quote-unquote, evidence, they have it. This is something that, you know, has kind of been normalized by mass culture, not only social media, and I don't have a Facebook page or Twitter or any of that stuff, but, you know, we've been seduced into surrendering all of our privacy as if it's a good thing. I mean, that's what kind of reality television is, about, but that has extremely dangerous consequences because if there becomes social upheaval, any kind of unrest, the government has surveillance to is far and beyond anything the East German Stasi ever had, and that was the most sophisticated security and surveillance apparatus in human history until our own, which means that it's just it's almost impossible for us to move, say, or do anything that the government doesn't want.
Chris, I appreciate you coming on and sharing some insights with us. As always, thank you very much.
Thank you, Gary.
I'm Gary Null. That's the end of our program. Thank you all for listening. Look forward to sharing more tomorrow. Have a nice day.